In this video, we're going to focus on thyroid nodules and thyroid cancer. So in terms of thyroid neoplasms, or new growths, fortunately the statistics reveal that only about one, some of the sources say up to 5% of thyroid masses actually prove to be malignant. So it's not common, but all thyroid masses need to be investigated. And the thing I'll just say from the start is that the size of the nodule or the thyroid mass does not necessarily correlate with its malignant potential. So size isn't really the main indicator here. Remember, in terms of neoplasms, a neoplasm is just a tumor. That's an uncontrolled growth of new cells. And it can be benign or malignant. An adenoma would be a benign tumor of glandular epithelium. An adenocarcinoma would be a malignant tumor of glandular epithelium. Carcinoma would be a malignant neoplasm of epithelial cells, and a sarcoma, a malignant neoplasm of mesenchymal tissue. So just keep those words and those terms in mind. Again, most masses, over 90%, turn out to be non-neoplastic lumps of nodular goiter. So they're actually normal thyroid tissue, but they're just maybe hyperproliferating a little bit, and that's part of goiter formation. A few turn out to be neoplasms, but many of those are benign, and they are non-toxic adenomas. So lumps on the thyroid aren't necessarily adenomas. They could just be normal goiterous thyroid tissue. A small percentage of those will be adenomas, and then a small percentage of those could be adenocarcinomas, etc. Non-palpable nodules, what we call incidentalomas, have the same risk of malignancy as palpable nodules. So these might be picked up on ultrasound or so forth. So again, the size doesn't really determine the malignant potential of the nodules. The features in terms of thyroid nodules, they're extremely common, but again, malignant ones are not common. More common in females, we think they're in up to 4% of females in the U.S. population. The female-to-male ratio is 4-1. They might be detected on ultrasound in up to 50% of healthy individuals, the so-called incidentalomas, and more than 95% of them are benign. So thyroid cancer is relatively rare. Now, there's a few factors that we can look at that make a nodule more likely to be malignant or more likely to be benign. In terms of history, I'll just go in the benign category here first. A family history of benign goiter, residents in any endemic goiter areas, like with low iodine, going to be more likely benign. In terms of more likely malignant, a family history of medullary thyroid cancer or any other thyroid cancer, previous therapeutic irradiation of the head and neck, so any radiation exposure to the head and neck, a recent kind of sudden onset of the nodule and enlargement, and then any signs of hoarseness, dysphagia, obstruction, indicating more of a larger goiter or growth. So those would be more likely malignant. In terms of more likely benign, in age and sex, middle age and females, more likely benign. Whereas more likely malignant would be children, or so anyone under 30 and over 70 and in males. So a younger male, 20 years old, with a sudden onset nodule or growth in the thyroid, is going to be more likely malignant to a middle-aged female having a similar type of growth. In terms of physical characteristics, more likely benign in older women, and a multinodular goiter with multiple masses is more likely benign, and nodules that when you palpate them feel soft, versus in terms of more likely malignant children, young adults, males, as I mentioned, solitary nodules, firm nodules, clearly different from the rest of the gland, so it just doesn't feel the same texture or consistency. And then any sort of vocal cord paralysis, firm lymph nodes, distal, any sort of enlarged lymph nodes in the neck, all that would be more likely malignant. In terms of more likely benign, having high titers of thyroid autoantibodies, interestingly, we think that some of them might actually be protective, especially in the context of low thyroid hormone. And then more likely malignant would be something like elevated calcitonin. Remember, that's from the parafollicular or C cells, and that would indicate a growth in those. Having a hot nodule on RAIU, in other words, hypersecreting, those are almost never malignant. They're almost always benign. And then having a cold nodule, up to 95% of them are benign, but we have to really investigate that smaller percentage which could be malignant. So higher malignant potential in cold nodules. Sonogram might reveal a cystic nodule, and that's going to be a clear fluid on the inside that's benign, versus a solid or more complex tumor with irregular edges would be more likely malignant. And then on final aspiration biopsy, the cytology would be more benign, you know, obviously on histology with that, with a benign nodule, versus we'd see some, you know, suspicious looking cells or actual malignancy on the needle biopsy with malignancy. And then TSH suppression therapy, this would be not something, again, this would be a more specialized test in endocrinology, but injecting the patient with TSH, we typically see more regression of benign nodules and no regression of malignant nodules. That's not going to be typically done to evaluate the nodules, but that's one other characteristic. So knowing some of these differences with the physical characteristics, age, history, etc., can be helpful clinically for giving us an idea of maybe where to go in terms of the workup for the nodules. So I mentioned in the earlier slide the 1% malignancy rate. Up to date in 2019 suggests that the incidence of malignancy in solitary nodules is up to 5%, so a little higher. The small asymptomatic nodules are common. Many actually go unnoticed. Again, many are just detected on ultrasound. They're the so-called incidentalomas. A goiter, remember, can have one nodule, that's uninodular, multiple nodulars, multinodular, or be diffuse. And again, metabolically, they can be inactive, the non-toxic or cold nodules, or active, they can secrete thyroid hormone, they're called toxic or hot nodules. So hot and cold are just all other terms used there. In terms of benign nodules, a benign adenoma is usually solitary, round, discrete, painless. Most common in females, most are non-functional. They don't secrete thyroid hormone, they're non-toxic, and most don't develop into carcinomas. A thyroid cyst, as I mentioned, would be hollow, fluid-filled. We could have a multinodular goiter. Those would all be in the benign category. In terms of non-benign nodules, a toxic adenoma, there's going to be increased risk of thyroid hormone, so it's not benign, not because it's going to lead to cancer, but because of thyroid toxicosis in this case. A toxic multinodular goiter, again, thyroid toxicosis. And then there are four different types of thyroid cancer, which we'll talk about here in the next slide. So when you, on physical exam, come across a nodule in the patient, what do we need to do? Well, first, get a complete history and physical. So our labs need to be drawn to actually see if the patient is hyper or hypo or euthyroid. So if the patient has normal or elevated TSH, that would suggest a euthyroid or primary hypothyroidism. Obtain an ultrasound to confirm the nodule. And then for nodules greater than a centimeter in size, or if they look suspicious on ultrasound, we're going to order the fine needle aspiration biopsy. So typically when I send out for ultrasounds, like the Epic imaging or something, I'll write on there, you know, they'll ask, you know, is it okay to do the needle biopsy if indicated, and usually say yes, and then they'll just do that based on the appearance of the nodule on ultrasound. If the TSH is low, or if there is increased or normal thyroid hormones, that's going to suggest a hyperthyroid or subclinical hyperthyroid state. That's where we get the RAIU scan. So different workups depending on what the thyroid status is. So hyperthyroid patients are going to get the RAIU scan. That's going to check for the uptake, and that will look for, you know, whether or not this nodule is a hot nodule to see if it's actually taking up more thyroid hormone. Once the hot nodule is confirmed, then you can order the ultrasound with the fine needle aspiration biopsy, and if there's any malignancy on that, we can refer for surgery. Again, it's been very rare to actually have a hot malignant nodule. So typically what I've seen with hot nodules is we can refer directly for treatment of hyperthyroidism, and it's addressed that way. Sometimes it's a little unclear, so that's why I put it here. We might want to get the biopsy with the fine needle aspiration biopsy. With the biopsy. If the nodule is benign with no compression symptoms, then we typically reassess the nodule in 6 to 12 months by physical exam and ultrasound. And if it grows by more than 20%, then repeat the biopsy. So that's the typical kind of assessment and workup of thyroid nodules. Again, it really depends on if the nodule is what we call a hot or a cold nodule. Now the treatment is going to, let me just say actually a few things about ultrasound here first. So in terms of features that might suggest malignancy, so having irregular margins, a lot of intranodular vascularity, a lot of microcalcifications would be more, all of these would be more suggestive of malignancy. There are six categories of fine needle aspiration biopsy results. So the report could come back non-diagnostic, benign. There could be follicular lesion of undetermined significance that could be benign or malignant, and usually that's referred to surgery to tell. Although increasingly there are now genetic tests that can be done. There's only a couple labs in the country that do them, but I've seen a few endocrinologists from the biopsy sample send it in for typing in terms of what kinds of cell markers are on those cells, and that can actually determine if they're more benign or malignant. We can get the result coming back that it's a follicular neoplasm, suspicious for malignancy, or it's actually malignant, and that's when we refer for surgery, typically thyroidectomy with the radioactive iodine combined in those cases. So the aspiration biopsy has a fine, high diagnostic accuracy for several of the different types of thyroid cancer, so papillary carcinoma, medullary thyroid carcinoma, and that would have a high calcitonin as well, and then anaplastic carcinoma. So the treatment is going to vary depending on the size, the type, and the category. And so our options could include active surveillance, thyroidectomy, high-intensity focused ultrasound, HIFU, it's a new therapy that's being used there, and then thyroid replacement as needed to, if the thyroid goes hypothyroid, to deal with that. Indications for surgery would be any nodule in excess of 4 centimeters, and that's because even if it's not malignant, it's going to have some compressive effects that we need to deal with. Any signs of or symptoms of compressive effects, any signs of malignancy, vocal cord dysfunction, lymphadenopathy, etc., and then cytopathology that doesn't exclude thyroid cancer, those would all be additional indications for surgery. Finally, let me just review some of the thyroid cancers here. So they arise from the epithelium that lines the thyroid follicles. Again, they're uncommon, about 1% of all cancers, mostly occurs in adults. We went over all the features. Again, we're gonna have a spike in younger patients and older patients as well. So go back and look at those features of what makes a nodule more likely to be malignant. Risk factors, radiation would be one, but there's potential for environmental risk factors and so forth, and so this is not well understood in terms of what causes directly thyroid cancer. Again, although rare, all single thyroid masses should be biopsied, again, depending really on the ultrasound features that we're going to see. So the different types of thyroid cancers, we can, again, with cancer, talk about what we call differentiated cancers versus undifferentiated. Differentiated meaning the cells look almost like normal cells. They're just overgrowing versus undifferentiated. They look more like stem cells. And those are the ones that are much more severe and have much higher metastatic potential and are much more aggressive. So fortunately, two types of thyroid cancers here, the papillary and follicular, are well differentiated. And we stage them by the so-called TNM, tumor node metastasis system. So that's common for a lot of different types of solid cancers. And the treatment's going to vary. It depends on really the type of cancer, the age of the patient, and the size of the tumor. So our first cancer here would be papillary thyroid cancer. It's about 80% of all thyroid cancers. There's several different subtypes of papillary thyroid cancer. I'm not going to get into that here. But it's most common in females between 20 and 50 years of age and in children. Very slow growing, well differentiated. Generally firm and solid nodules, often with internal calcification. 10% of patients will present with enlarged cervical nodes at the time of diagnosis. And the growth looks more, we call papillary, it's cauliflower or fern-like growths of the epithelial tissues. And thyroglobulin can actually be used as a tumor marker because that's going to increase as the tumor becomes larger. This one spreads via the lymph and lymph nodes. Unlike the others here, which spread more to the blood, this is more to the lymph nodes. And positive lymph nodes most often appear as a painless neck mass. So again, we're always going to be doing a full neck exam for patients, and that's one of the things we're going to look for is any enlarged lymph nodes. Responds well to treatment, so the 5-year survival rate for papillary thyroid cancer is over 90%. For treatment, we divide patients into a low risk and high risk group. So low risk would be less than 45 years of age, the lesions less than 2 centimeters, versus high risk is over 45, lesions more than 2 centimeters, or evidence of lymphatic spread. So for low risk, the treatment is typically lobectomy, or a lobe of the thyroid where that cancer is found is removed, or complete thyroidectomy, and then T4 therapy for life. With a high risk group, it's thyroidectomy with the radioactive iodine therapy, and that's follow up every 6 to 12 months. In terms of the next cancer here, that's follicular thyroid cancer. That's about 10% of all the thyroid cancers. More common again in females over 50. Small follicles with poor colloid formation. Again, thyroglobulin can be used as a tumor marker. And this one's more likely to metastasize via the blood than the lymph. So it's going to spread through the body via the venous system. But again, the 5-year survival rate is high at 91%. And the typical therapeutic approaches are exactly the same as papillary thyroid cancer. Medullary thyroid cancer is about 5% of all thyroid cancers, and that's proliferation of the parafollicular cells. So we have increased calcitonin and CEA, or tumor markers that can be used for that. These are more aggressive than the first two, and again, they spread via both the lymph, in this case, and the blood. So we get distal metastases that way. Often associated with other familial syndromes that can lead to cancers and different endocrine disorders like multiple endocrine neoplasia 2A and 2B. So again, a family history of that might increase the risk. And the 5-year survival rate here is still fairly high at 80%. So thyroidectomy, external beam radiation, and a new class of drugs, the protein kinase inhibitors, could all be used for medullary thyroid cancer. And then we have anaplastic thyroid cancer. That's the least common, about 3% of all thyroid cancers. And it's unfortunately, though, the most aggressive. It's actually one of the most aggressive of all human cancers. This occurs mostly in elderly patients. About 80% of patients' cases are fatal within a year. And this one metastasizes very quickly. So therapy here is complete thyroidectomy, radioactive iodine therapy, T4 therapy for life. But again, very poor prognosis. Finally, the thyroid, and we saw this with Hashimoto's, can develop lymphomas. So that would be treated. I'm not going to discuss the treatment for lymphoma here, but that would be treated like we treat lymphomas. So that is an overview of the 4 basic types of thyroid cancer plus lymphoma. So have an understanding of kind of the differences, but know that papillary and follicular thyroid cancers are considered well differentiated and have a much better prognosis, especially than the anaplastic thyroid cancer. So that wraps it up for thyroid pathology. There's a lot of material, but again, this is a very common patients will often present to primary care, but also integrative care settings to have their thyroid issues addressed. And so it's important to really understand all the ins and outs of what can happen with the thyroid and how we can approach treatment.